Can we start? यस्मात् जातं जगत् सर्वं यस्मिन्येव प्रलीयते येनेदं धार्यते चैव तस्मै ज्ञानात्मने नमः ईश्वरो गुरुरात्मेति मूर्तिभेदविभागिने व्योमवद्व्याप्तदेहाय दक्षिणामूर्तये नमः तैत्तिरीयकसारस्य मयाचार्यप्रसादतः विस्पष्टार्थरुचीनां हि व्याख्येयं संप्रणीयते ॐ सहनावतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सहवीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः ॐ भीषास्माद्वातः पवते भीषोदेति सूर्यः भीषास्मादग्निश्चेन्द्रश्च मृत्युर्धावति पंचम इति सैषानन्दस्य मीमा गुंसा भवति युवास्यात् साधु युवाध्यायकः आशिष्टो दृढिष्टो बलिष्ठः तस्येयं पृथिवी सर्वा वित्तस्य पूर्णा स्यात् स एको मानुष आनन्दः ते ये शतं मानुषा आनन्दाः स एको मनुष्यगन्धर्वाणाम् आनन्दः श्रोत्रियस्य चाकामः तस्य ते ये शतं मनुष्यगन्धर्वाणाम् आनन्दाः स एको देवगन्धर्वाणाम् आनन्दः श्रोत्रियस्य चाकामः तस्य ते ये शतं देवगन्धर्वाणाम् आनन्दाः स एकपितृणां चिरलोकलोकानाम् आनन्दः श्रोत्रियस्य चाकामः तस्य ते ये शतं पितृणां चिरलोकलोकानाम् आनन्दाः स एक आजानजानां देवानाम् आनन्दः श्रोत्रियस्य चाकामः तस्य ते ये शतम् आजानजानां देवानाम् आनन्दाः स एक कर्म देवानां देवानाम् आनन्दः ये कर्मणा देवानपि यन्ति श्रोत्रियस्य चाकामः तस्य ते ये शतं कर्म देवानाम् आनन्देवानाम् आनन्दाः स एको देवानाम् आनन्दः श्रोत्रियस्य चाकामः तस्य ते ये शतं देवानाम् आनन्दाः स एक इन्द्रस्यानन्दः श्रोत्रियस्य चाकामः तस्य ते ये शतम् इन्द्रस्यानन्दाः स एको बृहस्पतेरानन्दः श्रोत्रियस्य चाकामः तस्य ते ये शतम् बृहस्पतेरानन्दाः स एक प्रजापतेरानन्दः श्रोत्रियस्य चाकामः तस्य ते ये शतम् प्रजापतेरानन्दाः स एको ब्रह्मण आनन्दः श्रोत्रियस्य चाकामः तस्य स यश्चायं पुरुषे यश्चासावादित्ये स एकः स य एवंवित् अस्माल्लोकात् प्रेत्य एतमन्नमयमात्मानमुपसङ्क्रामति एतं प्राणमयमात्मानमुपसङ्क्रामति एतं मनोमयमात्मानमुपसङ्क्रामति एतं विज्ञानमयमात्मानमुपसङ्क्रामति एतमानन्दमयमात्मानमुपसङ्क्रामति तदप्येष श्लोको भवति. So we are still in this long piece, which is a critical enquiry into Ananda. Ananda Brahmananda Mimamsa. The entire enquiry is, what is this Ananda? Which is the, we are on the end of Brahmananda only. So this is the final, grand finale to all the discussions that we have had in terms of what is this Brahman, what is the creation process. So many things it has said. finally it has come to the stage of analyzing happiness. So as you may, since it is 2 weeks, let me recall a little bit. We all must have forgotten a little bit. 2 weeks we haven't. It's a yuvasyat, it takes a unit of analysis. Yuvasyat, a young man. Sadhu yuva, pious man. Yuvasyat sadhu yuva dhyayakaha, adhyayakaha. He is well read, which means he has all the knowledge to also materially be richer. Yuvasyat sadhu yuva dhyayakaha, adrishto dridishto balishtaha. So he is very industrious. He is healthy. He is endowed with all riches that he can have. So there are six conditions. Prithivi tasya vittasya purna syat. His spread of land is up to the end of the world. So it is taking a very ideal kind of a unit of happiness. Sa eko manusha anandaha. So hypothetically takes a massive unit of happiness and calls it as one unit of happiness. And with this one unit of happiness, it wants to actually analyze happiness. What is this happiness? And as we saw, which quickly I will take again, we went up to 10 followed by 20 zeros. 1 followed by 20 zeros. That many unit of happiness. 10 power 20. Up to that it went. It raised 100, 100, 100, 100. I read the whole passage. It went up to 10 power 20. That kind of happiness. We will leave this. This is a very large chunk of happiness. We'll leave it for the moment. We'll come back to it a little later. We will talk about happiness first, which I haven't done. We have been only getting into this 10 power 20 happiness. I want to little bit talk about happiness. We will talk about ananda. At our level, we all actually want ananda. Nobody says, I want to have dukkha. I don't think anybody is going to say that. We all want ananda. In fact, ananda is a very fundamental requirement of ourselves. So let us understand that, then we'll come to this. Anyway, we have seen it, but we'll first understand what is this ananda that we are talking. At an ordinary mortal like us, we want happiness. And let us see, what is this Shruti saying? What is it pointing to? How do you relate that to the happiness that we have? We'll do a little bit of our own. So I took some 10 situations let us see that. Let us take some examples. First example is a 2-year-old child, okay, plays with a new object. It could be a toy or it can be a new object. It can be your spectacle, but it will not leave it. It plays with it, it discovers its ananda. There is a notion of ananda. A 2-year-old child, there is a new object, on seeing it, that's why when you take it out of it, the ananda is ending, that's why it cries. So even in that small little child, there is this notion of ananda. Let us understand that. Then I move on. A 10-year-old boy obtains a new video game, or a PS3, PlayStation, or something. There is this notion of ananda. Of course, that boy enjoys happiness. There is a notion of ananda there. So even the second example, there is a notion of ananda. And then we'll move. A girl or a boy gets his favorite gadget or a dress or a jewel. That brings a certain element of ananda. And mind you, in all these examples, as I go progressively, in all these examples, there may be a whole lot of effort involved to get that ananda. So ananda also does not come just like that. There is a certain effort. As human beings, we put effort. And we put effort because we have a notion of ananda. And we want to pursue that notion of ananda. Therefore, we channelize our efforts, and then there is this ananda. So, I am taking simple examples. One can extend the logic to several things that we may be doing in our life. I am only taking a few simple examples. So, let's move further. Now, I have taken examples in our entire lifespan. I don't want to just take a 2-year-old example. I want to go up to 80 years. to convey the point that sakala jiva rashi ananda is something very fundamental. That is the point I want to drive, so I am taking a few examples. A student obtains the first rank in the state level examination. Imagine he or she gets a certain notion of ananda. What went behind it is a different thing. But the fact remains that they rejoice, there is this notion of ananda. A professional gets a dream job of his or her choice. That's a, you know, there is an ananda there. You know, they are very happy about it. So again, I have moved. You know, we have gone to 25, 30 years now. Okay? One finds a matching life partner is an expression of ananda for people. So there is ananda even in that. One obtains career progress the way he or she likes. In fact, there are a lot of reasons why we don't have ananda are the counter-examples of this. You take counter-examples, all of these, we seem to have lost ananda. The kind of examples that I am talking. One gets his son, daughter married as per their choice, liking, and that of the son and the daughter. All joined together, that is ananda for that person who has done several things for their parents who are moved far away in their life. So the point I am trying to make is, there are two things which we need to understand. First of all, ananda is a fundamental attribute of us. We endeavor for it. The question is, where is this ananda coming from? This ananda cannot be in any of the objects or in the outside world. So we have to lay a few rules very clearly. The ananda is not in the event. I spoke several events. We all think the ananda is in the event. I got a promotion, therefore I am happy. The ananda was not in the promotion. The question is, where is this ananda? This feeling of the happiness. The feeling of happiness is actually inside. It is nowhere outside. Some example will clarify it. Some people love to eat a certain sweet, love to eat a certain dish. Now the ananda cannot be in the dish. Because if the ananda, let us assume for the moment that the ananda is in the dish. It is not in the subject, it is in the object. See, there are two here. There is a subject experiencing and there is an object. Now, if you say the ananda is on the object, it is easy to shoot it down. Because if the ananda is in the object, all of us should get the same ananda when we eat it. Some people hate the same food. Some people enjoy it so much, some people enjoy it less, some people hate it. So, use that logic, we know that ananda is not on the object. So, ananda is now, first of all, we have to understand ananda is not outside. In fact, in Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, Maitreyi and Yajnavalkya, there is a wonderful prakarna. You know, which Maitreyi, Yajnavalkya says, you love your husband not because you are, you know, don't understand it that way, because it is good in your heart, it benefits you. I have quoted this once long back in Bhagavad Gita class. He goes on explaining example after example after example and says, you do good things to others not because of anything, because it generates happiness in you. He gives several examples like that. Finally, he says, you love your husband and son not because they are to be loved. It generates something good in you. If it is not generating good in you, you will not. So there is Anantamayi Prakarana. There is one Prakarana in Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. He explains very elaborately, taking several examples. So first of all, the ananda is somewhere inside, not outside. Now, moment you say ananda is inside, then we get into another kind of a problem. Is the ananda in the, you know, the heart, or is it in the veins, or is it in the sthula sharira? Then we'll get into that problem now. Is it in the sthula sharira? Is it in the sukshma sharira? Where is it? So this is one issue which is there. In fact, I didn't want so much talk about that, but that is also there. So ananda is an attribute which you radiate, all of us radiate, for different measure, all that. But the ananda that is being talked here, where it started, sa eko manushya anandaha, te yeshatam manushyanam anandaha, shrotriyas, like that it is going. This is going in a different level. Now, how do you relate that to this? So So there are a few things which we need to understand about this ananda. These are a simple example that has taken it to a slightly higher quotient. So the first of all, what is happening in all these examples which I gave? You know, I said the 2-year boy plays with it, all that examples that we have taken. Let's analyze what is going on here. First thing, the ananda in all these examples is obtained by Vishaya Sukham or Anubhava. There is an experience which is giving me the ananda. It is experiential. The ananda is a matter of experience. And that experience, I am only saying, happening inside, not outside. That's all I mean. When I say ananda is not outside, ananda is not on the food dish. What I meant is that experience called ananda is happening inside, not outside. So first of all, it is experiential of a Vishaya Sukha. And for different of us, it can be differently there. There is no doubt ananda is there in all these cases. Then there are a few other properties which we need to understand in all these cases extending up to this. And that is, this ananda is limited. It's not unlimited. It is limited in terms of time. If you get a promotion, 2 hours, 2 days, maybe a month, then your grief starts, next list starts. So, this ananda that we are talking, so far what we are talking, has to be limited. Limited in terms of time, limited in terms of space, limited in all these vastu. Because the same vastu will now no longer be an ananda. A sweet which I loved so much, after diabetic I develop, if I'm fortunate enough, I'll develop hatred. Otherwise I'll continue with ananda and take some other tablet to sort it out. So what I am saying is the ananda that all the examples, that's what is happening to the child. After 5 minutes, he just throws it off. It is not finding ananda anymore. And it can be limited. So the first property is this, all these ananda that we are experiencing is happening inside, property one. Property two, it has to be limited in terms of time, place, effect. I mean, the counter is also true. I frequently explain this. Counter is also true. Dukkha and ananda are actually in a plane. It's like, you know, your in your Kevin scale, you have, you know, 0, 2. There's nothing like heat and cold. There's nothing like heat and cold. It is only a gradation of calories of energy. I mean, in Vyavahara, we may say it is hot and it is cold. Cold is also temperature, hot is also temperature. It's only in a different. So the Sukha and Dukkha, Ananda and Ananda are in the same continuum. So the properties are similar. Just to give you, this is a wonderful example which I have quoted several times, but I won't bring it because these are very important. There was a guru and a student who was a very good student, a brilliant student. So he finished his classes, everything was over, Gurukula, everything was over. And Taittiriya Upanishad says in the Shikshavalli, after you pass out, get married. Prajatantum avyavachetsi acharyaya priyam dhanamahritya. Prajatantum, the thread of offspring, don't cut. Mavyavachetsi. That's how that beautiful last Anuvaka, where we saw a lot of convocation address. So this boy passes out of his course, he gets married. Brilliant boy, very cultured boy. He gets married, a beautiful wife, everything is fine. In about a year or two, this wife dies one day. Her prarabdha is over, she goes. So this boy is in great grief. Young boy and all that, obviously he is so upset. So this guru happened to know about it. So he came and then he met this boy and he spoke some Vedanta to him. You know, he said, Vasamsi Jirnani Yatavi. I don't know what he said, but he spoke some Vedanta. So his boy was quite upset. Because he's grieving the loss of his dear wife and young lady and all that. So this boy, out of his emotion, he spoke a little. Told the guru, what are you sort of saying? it's a big loss that I have gone through, and you are trying to little bit with a less respect. So this guru silently withdrew and went away. After 3 months, after a few days, this boy was feeling bad. I should not have spoken. Again, Bhagavad Gita says, Atakena Praiktoyam Papam Charati Purusha Anichanapi Vashneya Baladi Vanyojin, chapter 3. Why did I become a victim of situation? This is another example. So he felt, why did I talk like this to my guru? I should not have. So this was a guilty consciousness in him. He was a nice student, very cultured boy. So after 3 months, it was just eating his head. So one day he went to the guru. Guru went and told him, sir, the other day you came. And I think I have overstepped my brief and I have been a little bit disrespectful to you. So guru smiled at him and said, no, don't worry, all those are fine. Can you do me a small favor? No, sir, whatever favor you want, that is my job, I will do. The other day when I came, you are crying so profoundly. Sit for 1 hour and cry. He couldn't. The boy couldn't cry. This is so, dukkha and ananda are temporary. Dukkha is also temporary. Agamo paino anityaha tam titikshasva bharata is what Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita. It says, matra svarshast kaunteya sitoshna sukha dukkata. It will blow hot and cold. Life is like that. So all these are in the domain of temporariness. That's where I wanted to tell this story. Ananda is also temporary. Dukkha is also temporary. But our mental makeup is such that we feel ananda is so short-lived and dukkha is so long. These are all our own mental models. We are spoiling ourselves. The choice is ours. We are spoiling ourselves. We feel dukkha is overwhelming for me and ananda is too short-lived for me. So these are all mental models with which we live. So Vedanta, when we read Vedanta, it can challenge us a little bit of some of these principles. Anyway, so it is temporary, does not last for too long. All the anandas are like that, and dukkha is another version of ananda according to me. Then the third thing in all these examples, that's why this example comes very profoundly, is the ananda also has gradation in terms of its impact, in terms of its quantum, in terms of what it can do to you. There is a gradation. Some ananda is a lot more for you, some ananda is just like that passing sort of a thing. So there is a gradation effect also. So these are all the properties that we have, that it is limited, it is temporary, it has gradation effect, it is not all the time there, it disappears, and all these. So all these, you know why all these are happening? Because all these anandas are coming from anandamaya kosha. We talked about 5 koshas. All these anandas are coming from anandamaya kosha. That's why it's called kosha ananda. Kosha is only an enclosure. However big it is an enclosure at the end of the day. So ananda is a kosha ananda, which is what we found. Now the question is there something more than this? Is there something more than this? Or is it all? Because this whole argument, so now we'll see this argument which we saw last time. We'll see this argument which we saw last time. We started with Manushya's ananda. Then 100 times is Manushya Gandharva. Then we said 100 times of Manushya Gandharva is Deva Gandharva. 100 times Deva Gandharva is Pitru Gandharva. Then Chiralokas. 100 times of that. So we went on like this. Karma Deva, this long passage talked only about this. So these are all graded. So ananda up to the point, however the 10 power 20 may look very big. However big it looks, in Brihadaranyaka Upanishad says, even this ananda is nothing but an iota of, you know, this. There is something called ananda sagar. This is like one drop from ananda sagar. That is what he says. All this is also nowhere near. There is this satyam. That's why Taittiriya Upanishad Brahmananda only started by saying satyam jnanam anantam brahma. That's where it started. Satyam jnana and ananda will give ananda. That framework is nothing but embodiment of ananda. He says this is nothing. Brihadaranyaka Upanishad says this is just like a drop from a ocean of that brahmananda, final ananda that we are talking about. So there is a gradation. Now why is this coming? It says, Shrotriyasya cha akamahatasya. A person who is a Kshatriya, which means he is well versed in the Veda, he has understood the Vedic framework, internalized it and practicing it so well. And Akamahataha. Kamahataha is one who is bitten by desire. Akamahataha is who is not bitten, who has transgressed the domain of desire. And the cha here, there is a cha. Kshatriyasya cha, Akamahatasya cha. Since it is coming in between, in every passage, everything it is coming in between, it is actually saying, you go to that level, that another he will experience. You go to the, Indrasya Nandaha, Kshatriyasya cha Kamahatasya, Te Yeshatam Indrasya Nandaha, Sayeko Brihaspatera Nandaha, Kshatriyasya cha Kamahatasya. So the cha is saying, oh, whatever gradation you are talking, that will come to this person also. The person who is a Kshatriya, person who is a Akamahataha. So, all these put together is actually telling something very interesting. What it is saying? This is still, it says it is limited Ananda, however big it is. It is still limited. So, there are two paths for limited Ananda now. This is what this passage is actually telling us. There are two paths for Ananda. One path is Vishaya Sukha. So you enjoy more, you get more in terms of quantum, but they are temporary. They are limited. They are constrained. There is an end to it. It's not endless. It's not unlimited. But, so all these gradations are Vishaya Sukha of, if you have more in Devaloka, they say there is more, then if you go into Gandharva Loka, it is something and so on. So this merely is saying there are two ways you can get the limited Ananda, however big it is still limited. One way is through Vishaya Sukha. That is what this circle is saying. But what is the middle one saying? The middle one is saying the same Ananda can be obtained not necessarily by Vishaya Sukha, by what is called Vairagya, dispassion. How do you become an Akamahataha? One way to have Ananda is to have it. One way to have Ananda is to be saying that without that I will be able to be there. In fact, that is much less constrained. This is more constrained. See, morning if I don't get coffee, there are two possibilities. Morning if I don't get coffee before 7:30, I get headache, let us say. So that Ananda is so constrained. So it's easy for me to take the Ananda out of you. I will deny coffee today to you. That Ananda is gone now. So the Vishaya Sukha Ananda is very constrained. Suppose if I mentally prepare and I do a little bit of tapas and say coffee or no coffee, nothing will happen in the morning. That is the middle variety in a very limited sense I am telling. A situation where I can live without something, that Ananda is much bigger than a situation in which you give me more, I'll enjoy more, and then you give me more, I'll enjoy more, so that I'll travel on that path. So this circular path is through Vishaya Sukha. The middle one which we have put is through Vairagya. And how do you get Vairagya? Vairagya comes because of your Kshatriya. You have understood the defining framework of Veda. The Vedic framework puts things in perspective. So a person who is able to understand, internalize and live through it, will say it is there or no, not there, we will be able to do what we want to do. So that is the significance of these two. So, but the Shruti very clearly says, all these, whichever way you go through Vairagya, or you go through the path of I have more endowment with me, therefore let me enjoy more. He says, both are limited. These are Koshananda. But there is the ultimate. So there is a third, or the second, or a third path, let me say, which will come only through Jnana Prapti. And that is that limitless Ananda. Now what is the difference between that Ananda and this Ananda? In that Ananda, object disappears. It's only subject. Moment you put a subject and object, limitations will come. Moment you bring a subject and that's what particle physics is also saying. If the observer and observed merge, then you are no longer Newtonian physics. You have gotten into particle physics now. It is unlimited. I mean, you are now all over the place. You do not know whether you are observer or you are observed. In other words, the important difference between this limited Ananda and the bigger Ananda is unlimited. It is constant. It is not temporary. It is not graded. And the only way you do it is, there is no objectification. The moment you objectify something, you get into
what is called this constraint of upadhi. There are material constraints. There may be a moment to objectify anything in the world. It has to live the laws of nature, which means it has to have a birth, it has to have a death. Anything that you can objectify, a concept, a company, an idea, an innovation, anything physical, all of them are belonging to that. So moment you objectify, you get into constraint. So the only way you become is, you become the observer and there is nothing to be observed. Which is like you are in the middle of the ocean and you are you know, looking for a piece of land, small piece of land. That is not possible. It's water, water and water. It is jnana maya. Jnana maya. It's only jnana and nothing else. Whereas all these are koshananda. Anandamaya kosha. That's why annamaya kosha, pranamaya kosha, manonmaya kosha, vijnanamaya kosha and anandamaya kosha. It is just a limited piece, an enclosure. So that comes through jnana. Now the question is, do you get jnana? No, jnana is not to be obtained. Ajnana has to be removed. Jnana is already there. That is the argument. It is being, bandaged. And then it has to be peeled off. So the process that we are going through is a process in which we are trying to take layers. Once you take layers, it radiates by itself. It doesn't require any kind of supporting system for it. So that is the other one which it is now going to. Shruti is now ending this Brahmananda Valli, getting us there little bit. So far it is talking about this, but it has to take us to Satyam Jnanam Anantam Brahma. So it ends with that kind of a mantra, which is what here. So but before that, the same text that we saw in Taittiriya Upanishad is available in Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. Very similar, you see what it is saying. Slightly different, but the idea is same. Look at what it is saying. Sahayaha manushyanam radhaha is, fit and well equipped and so on. Samriddhaha, samriddhi, riches. He has everything. Samriddhaha, bhavati, he is there. Anyesham adhipati, he can court lordship on anybody. So it defines one unit of ananda in this fashion. Taittiriya defined it in a slightly different way, similar. Anyesham adhipatihi sarvaihi manushyakaihi bhogaihi sampannatamaha. Sampannatamaha is superlative. Sampat, sampannataraha, sampannatamaha. He has achieved all bhoga that all human beings can ever achieve. So it is defining it like that. Okay? Saha manushyanam paramaha anandaha. He says it is one unit of ananda for a manushya. Atha ye shatam manushyanam ananda, you take 100 such people, suppose there are 100 such people who have similar ananda, that is equal to, he says, ekaha pitrinam jitalokanam ananda. Same thing is coming differently. Atha ye shatam pitrinam jitalokanam ananda sa eko gandharva lokana lokaha ananda. So the gradation is explained the same way. Atha ye shatam gandharva loka anandaha sa eka karma devanam anandaha. Those who became devas by virtue of karma, smarta karmas, they become deva. So, karmanam devatvam abhi sampadyante. Through karma they get devatva. Through smarta karma, I explained all that in the Taittiriya Upanishad when we looked at similar thing only. Atha ye shatam karma devanam anandaha sa eka ajana devanam anandaha. Yes, chair, same thing. Until then it didn't bring it, now it is bringing. The same thing is shrotriyaha avrijinaha akamahataha. Avrijinaha is sinless. It is adding one more adjective there. There it says shrotriya and akamahata. It added avrijinaha also. Ye shatam ajana devanam anandaha sa eka prajapati loka anandaha. It says that is ananda of one prajapati. Yascha shrotriyaha avrajinaha akamahataha ata yeshatam prajapati loka anandaha sa eko brahma loka anandaha. Yascha shrotriyaha avrajinaha akamahataha yaisha evam paramam anandaha yesha brahma lokaha. Samrat, he is addressing Janaka. This is a conversation between Janaka and Yajnavalkya. So whenever he says Samrat in Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, Yajnavalkya is telling to Janaka. Because the story is, Janaka said, whoever tells me the truth, I will give you these 1,000 cows with... So that is the conversation here. Samrat, iti hi uvacha Yajnavalkyaha. Same passage is coming here. So, this passage is telling some important things that we need to understand about bliss, about this ananda. Bliss is not at all dependent on external objects. Quite often in our vyavahara, in our day-to-day life, in fact, most of the problem is we think our happiness is on our children, on our better half, on our bandhavaha, bandhujanaha. That is where Arjuna also started in his Mahabharata war also, that's where he started. So we misplace the locus of, no, I am not saying because of my son or daughter I get ananda, I am not denying that. You are not understanding the locus of it. If you understand the locus of it, you become a little more objective when certain things happen. You can be a little objective in life. That's all we are coming to. Look at the locus. The locus is not outside. Bliss is not dependent on external objects. By increasing the wealth and material comforts, one can increase bliss is not a valid data at all, valid idea at all. Because increasing material wealth and are all outside matters. Whereas ananda is inside. So it is illogical to connect these. In reality, we think like that. But it is illogical. Ananda is not outside, it is inside. So by merely increasing it, ananda will go up is not a necessarily a good assumption. And the day when the assumption proves wrong, we should be ready to take it. And if you have to take it, we should understand the locus is inside, not outside.
Sir, can
you
say that the source is inside, the trigger points are outside?
Ha, you can say that. For an untrained mind, the trigger points are outside. Which is called Indriyartha. Indriyani and Indriyartha. For a trained mind, that's why Akamahataha, there is source is also inside, na? Source is not, that's the difference between these two. But he revels, Atmanyeva Atma Triptaha, Atma Santushtaha, Atmanyeva Bhavati. You can revel, however adversarial the outside world is, inside you can be at peace. You can experience the bliss inside, that's a choice you can make. That's the other variety. Experiences and things it is outside.
For a Kshatriya, it's always
inside. That is the difference. So, ability to attain the innermost center of ourself. So, why is this Panchakoshas? It is taking us slowly to that epicenter of every one of us. Every one of us have epicenter. That's where resides that ananda. That's where it resided when I was a 2-year-old child, when I took the toy and then played, from there it came. That's where it came when I got my promotion. That's where it came when I found a fortune. It is inside there. So these 5 koshas, if you can peel, objectively understand, that's what the previous anuvakas are in Brahmananda Valli. So if you can understand the 5 koshas and then objectively understand, you'll open one layer at a time and then go inside. So ananda is the innermost layer is annamaya kosha. That's why in Annamaya Kosha, it says Brahma Pucham Pratishta. Finally, it ended like that. It said, the support of all this is the ultimate Brahman, which is sitting inside, innermost. You have to open this also and see that. Hridaya Kuhare. Panchamukho Asti Mekuto Bihi. Shivananda Lahiri says, there is this 5-faced lion sitting in my heart. I am not worried. That's what he, describes it in a different way. So the one who knows to approach the innermost layer and develops dispassion with the outside will get that infinite peace. So far it is all limited peace. Limited can be, you can still have a gradation. Shruti is saying there is an infinite peace, you should go there. That is what is far more enduring than looking at this. That's what it is saying. So it moves on. Now it brings that concept. So far it is talking Kosha Ananda, which is all limited. Now it says, let's look at the other person. Sa yaschayam puruṣe, yascha sa vaditye, sa ekah, saya evamvit, asmaloka pretyat. Remember, there was one question. Uta vidvan amul lokam pretya, kaschana gaschati. There was a question it asked, what happened to this person who knew all these when he died? Amullokam pretya. After he goes out of this, what will happen? Answer is coming here. It is saying that person who knew will actually merge into the ocean instead of being a drop. This 10 power 20 ananda is still a drop. If he knows this inside of the everything, he will merge into the ocean. That's what it is saying. Saha yaha cha ayam purushaha. That ultimate truth is this person. Yascha asau adityaha. That sun also is the same material. If a person, saha ekaha. This is called Mahavakya. This is a different version of Aham Brahmasmi, Tattvamasi. This is the same Mahavakya coming in a different way. It talks about the oneness. It says that ultimate principle is this person. That ultimate principle is also the sun. That's what it is saying. Yes cha asau adityaha. Yes cha sa vaditye sa ekaha. You discover the oneness. If you saw through the game and discover the oneness, saya evam vit, one who understands thus. Evam vit, vit is to know. Evam is thus. A person who saw through the game and understood this, he would have dismantled all these limitations. You understand meaning? He must experience it that way. So the objectification will come to an end. If everything is one, where is the object? If you have to have an object, there should be two now. Moment you say there is an object, there must be a subject now. Only then the very vocabulary object makes sense. In common parlance, we keep using it. You logically look at it. Moment you say there is an object, there is a subject. Only a subject can see object. If there is no object, that means there is only subject. You can't say there is only object, because if you say there is only object, you have seen it. There is a subject already there. So the only object cannot be argued, but only subject can be argued. That is what Upanishad is arguing. It is saying objectification will come to an end. Because why? Evam vit sa ekaha. World is one. If there is one, where is the second? So all objects will die. I mean, cease to exist. It will be a notional idea. It will cease to exist. If it ceases to exist, then you are all in the same boat. You are all in the same ocean. There is no division now. He says, in that stage, he will depart this world with that thought. Asman lokat pretya. And what will happen when he does it? Then it says, Yetam manamayam atmanam upasankramati. Sankramanam, we say Sankranti, Makara Sankranti we say, right? The Kra Dhatu is a line or a boundary or a limit. So when you cross it, it is crossing. That's why when the sun goes to the Uttrayana, we call it Sankranti. Samyak krayanam about it, utkramam, all these use the word, is to cross. Maybe from kra only cross came. Many English words are like that. From kra only probably English word cross also came, I think, because same meaning. So here it says that person who saw through this and understood the oneness, what will happen? How will he do it? He will pierce one layer at a time. He will first find this body is not mine, I am not the body. This body is not mine, the body is not for me. Deham naham, koham soham, sahaham. He will see through that game. So he will see this body belongs, the first, second anuvaga, we will understand the meaning of it. The second anuvaga, that's what we said. This body is coming from tasma at anno shadamuchyate, anna at bhutani jayante, jatan anyena vardante. First anuvaga, second anuvaga will come. He will see this world of bodies, and annam is a word, because every body is manufactured out of food. Every body becomes food for that ultimate God again. He explained that. He will experience that feeling. Moment he experiences the feeling, he has actually peeled his layer called body. Let's say Ramana Maharishi said, cut and do whatever you want to do, because it's not me. He has already crossed this layer. That's why he said, no, nothing, no anesthesia and all that, do water, because it's not me. I am not the body. He is able to say that. So that's the first layer. he will see the whole world of physical entities are coming from Virat, which is called Anna. He will experience the world like that. So first layer is gone. So Annamaya Atma will become Annamaya Kosha. He will see it only as a layer now. He'll tear it off. Then he'll go to the next. Etam pranamayam atmanam upasankramati. He will find that this prana, there's a larger prana, which part of it is this prana. He will see, understand it. We talked all these in every anuvaka. He will experience it. Moment he experiences it, he doesn't attach anything to the prana which is usuru odadutta ide. In Kannada they say like that. It is going up and down. That he will not attach too much importance. He says it is part of a larger prakriti. Comes and goes is okay. He will go there. So the second layer is gone. Etam manomayam atmanam upasankram. He will find this consciousness belong to a larger consciousness from which it drew temporarily for some time. It will put it back there. Hiranyagarbha is that larger consciousness. He will now, that person who has realized this oneness will be able to tear this layer also. So like that it goes. Vijnanamayam atmanam upasankramati anandamayam. So it is tearing these five layers and getting into the epicenter which is being indicated here. As long as we are in the layer has its own limitation. So the ananda will be limited. Ananda will be only that much. If we understand how to do repeated meditation and slowly one step at a time we are able to do it, we will go to the epicenter. Then all these limited ananda, you will develop an escape velocity to get out of this limitation itself. This limitation will no longer be a question because objectification is lost now. If objectification is lost, all these are gone. That is how it is explaining what will happen to the person. Because it asks, Uta vidvan amal lokam pretya kaschana gaschati ato vidvan amal lokam pretya kaschit samashmita. The two questions. Answer is here. He will know this. By not answering the other question, person avidvan, it says this will not happen. So it is silent on that question actually. But it answers two out of the three questions. So tadapyesha shloko bhavati, then it quotes the Rig Veda. This entire Brahmananda only is quoting Rig Veda. Tat api ekaha etaha shlokaha, you know, bhavati. Same idea is available in the Rig Veda, please see. That's how the whole Brahmananda only is. So tadapyesha shloko, every anuvaka will end with tatapyesha shloko bhavati. Then the next anuvaka will start by that quote. With the iti it will end. This is how we saw the structure. So we will see the same structure here. Yato vacho nivartante apraapya manasa saha anandam brahmano vidvan na bibeti kutaschana iti. With iti the quote ends actually. The Rig Veda quote ends, but the Anuvaka continues. Yetagum havavana tapati kimagum saduna karavam kimaham papam karamam iti saya evam vidvane te atmanag sprunute ubehye vaisha ete atmanag sprunute ya evam veda ityupanishat. It concludes Brahmananda Valli with this shloka, with a Rig Veda quote. So let us see, what is the Rig Veda saying? Rig Veda, we already saw it, so it's very interesting. What is Rig Veda saying? It is saying, yataha vachaha nivartante, speech is not able to reach. It has reached its limit. It is not able to go anymore. Yataha vachaha nivartante, it goes and comes back. It is not able to go. It's going only up to a point. Beyond that, it doesn't know how to go. Aprapya, without getting. Manasasaha, manas also went and failed and came back. So, for a person who have seen the ultimate truth, first thing you'll find is this manas. This vacha means indriyas. It is indicating the indriyas. Karma indriyas and jnana indriyas are indicated by the word vacha there. It is only a sample. So what it is saying, these karma indriyas, the jnana indriyas, buddhi, manas, ahankar are all objects. Objects cannot go. Objects are limited. Manas will be there only as long as somebody lives. After he dies, manas is gone. Right? Indriyas are there as long as the pranas are going up and down, other indriyas are gone. So, it cannot reach the ultimate. it has all the limitations of limited, constrained, graded, temporarily available, all those. So that person will understand that he, this will not reach, which means objectification comes to an end. And because he understood that, Anandam Brahmano Vidwan, he understood that which is beyond all that, is that ocean of bliss, of which this 10 power 20 is a drop. So Anandam Brahmano Vidwan, Na Bibeti, he is not shaken by anything. He is not shaken by anything, is not afraid of anything. Because please understand, but there was a conference on Chinmaya's, Vibhuti, there was a continuing conference on role of Advaita of humanity. So they asked me to talk about Advaita and leadership. I really, then my central argument was this. I said one of the important attributes for leadership is fearlessness. You should have fearlessness, otherwise what leadership? Now my entire argument of fearlessness was established on not having a Advaita. Where is fear coming? There is a second object only, fear will come. If you are the only one, where is the fear? I explained all that in Taittiriya Upanishad. Thus, all that were earlier that. Tasya bhayangato bhavati, all those we said. In that we analyze this fear. Here what it is saying, na bibeti kutaschaneti. Why? Because he has lost duality. Become one now. So where is parajaya? If there is only one, where is defeat and where is success, all these terms will disappear. All these terms will become meaningless for such a person. A person who is not able to go there will have all this meaning. I have lost, people have laughed at me, I have upset, I have failed, I have not achieved. These are all for people who are the world of duality. If he is able to go to a play, to a level in which he doesn't have to see duality, na bibeti kutaschaneti, never, he will transcend the domain of fear itself and go beyond that. So this is the impact of what will happen who dips into the ocean, who becomes Ananda himself. There is nothing other than Ananda when he goes there. So that is the Rigveda quote. Taking the Rigveda quote, the Taittiriya Upanishad adds a few more sentences emphasizing the same point, and it closes this whole discussion there. You will see those 2-3 lines.
येतगुम हवावन तपति किमगुम साधुना करवम किमहम पापम अकरवमिति सय एवं विद्वान एते आत्मानग स्पृणते उबे ह्ये वैश एते आत्मानग स्पृणते य एवं वेद इत्युपदिशत.
Now it says येतम Vanatapati, he doesn't get affected. He doesn't get affected by anything because he has now seen oneness. Only when there is a second thing, you get into all kinds of problems. He is more competitive, he is better than me, he is ahead of me. All these comes only when you have more than one. This person, for his own reason, he found only one. He found, unity in diversity. Law of conservation of divinity worked for him. And he found only one. If he found one, then the earlier questions all will disappear. Kim aham sadhu na akaravam. Akaravam is a past tense. Why did I not do good things in the past? Such a question will never come because these attributes of good and bad are all gone. So these questions are meaningless now. That is why the Taittiriya Upanishad says, Kim aham sadhu na akaravam. That will also go. Kim aham papam akaravam. Did I do bad? So this domain of good and bad will disappear. Domain of good and bad are required only when there is duality. As long as we experience duality, better follow it. As simple as saying, as long as you are driving a car, you need all the dharmas of car. Which means there is a red signal, you have to stop. If there is amber, you have to slow down. You should drive only on the left side of the road. All these are required only for somebody who is actually driving a car. If somebody said, I have now absolved myself of driving the car, he doesn't need any of those. Such rules make no meaning. In the same way, a person who has seen the whole world as one, for him there is nothing like good, there is nothing like bad, because there is no motive to do anything. He will spontaneously do what needs to be done. There is no motive of any kind. Because motives come only when you have a constituency, a subject and an object and a prayojana.
He says once he escapes that, kim aham sadhu na akaravam is also meaningless. Kim aham papam akaravam iti, that also will not make sense. So bad also he bothered, good also he doesn't bother. Saya evam vidwan ete atmanam, all these atman naspranate, he doesn't shake him. His vyaktitva will not be shaken by any of this. His vyaktitva will never be shaken by any of this. Ube, ubavapi, both of them will not, either ways it will only strengthen him, it will not shake him. Because he has lost the domain of good and bad. So he is not calculating anything, doing things. He will do things which requires a certain spontaneous response, he will do it. Value judgments are gone, impressions are gone, all the world of duality has disappeared. So he is a free bird. Technically speaking, he is a free bird. He or she is a free bird, nothing. Because none of these works for him. So ubo hi eshaha yete atman naspranate. Ya evam veda, understand it like this. The way the Upanishad says, let me tell you, this is, you asked, what will happen to the person who knew the Brahman? After he left this world, he will become absolutely constraintless. He is a free bird. For him, all domains will disappear. So bhakti is also that, you know, the immortality does not come in cinemas. They show immortality as somebody whose beard is growing longer and longer and longer. And then everybody is gone, he is still there. After 20,000 years also, he will tell a story, I was there 40,000 years back. That's not immortality. Immortality is a state where the vocabulary of death and birth has no meaning. Make these things irrelevant is immortality. That is called immortality. A person who is able to make the world of duality irrelevant, samadukka sukham dhiram, in 15th sloka in chapter 2 of Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, samadukka sukham dhiram, sa amritatvaya kalpate. He says exactly the same thing. He says a person who learned how to handle good and bad in life. Handle means he will not even blink his eye either ways. He says to me he has already reached immortality. That is the true definition of immortality, because if good and bad are not for me, what can affect me, including death? Nothing can affect me. Success cannot affect me, failure cannot affect me. Death cannot affect me, happiness cannot affect me, sadness cannot affect me. He says that is true immortality. That is the true meaning of immortality, not these movies showing some very weird elderly gentleman with anthills around him and all. These are all, you know, they are trying to dramatize it and try to put some kind of a mental model which many times are not serving the purpose. But that's how it goes. So it says, Iti Upanishad. So that is how the Upanishad actually says. With this comes the end of Brahmanandavalli. There is a Shanti Mantra at the end, which is the same Shanti Mantra that we had at the beginning. Om Sahana Vavatu, Sahanau Bhunaktu, Sahaviryam Karavavahai, Tejasvinabhadhitamastuma Vidvishavahai. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. This is the same Shanti Mantra both at the beginning and the end. Since we saw the Shanti Mantra already in detail, we will not see. This brings us to the closure of Brahmanandavalli. Then there is a beautiful father-son conversation called Bhrguvalli. Bhrgarvai varunihi varunam pitaram upasasara adihi bhagavo brumheti. It's an interesting passage. Same thing told in a different way. Bhrgu goes to his father Varuna and then he asks him a question. So that is Bhrguvalli. But before seeing it, we will, as the practice has been, we will see the summary of Brahmanandavalli. This is very, very important in Taittiriya Upanishad. Upanishad is only here. The rest are all around it. Upanishad Tattva is in Brahmanandavalli. Next week, we have the Gita Akanda Parayana. So please join. All of you, please join. 21st happens to be a Vaikuntha Ekadashi. So we do 18 chapters of Bhagavad Gita, one shot. It takes just 2 hours. Last year also, we did it. So we have decided to do it in the same menu. We have put it, we can once again just send it to the group again in case some of you have missed it. It is a temple nearby in the eastern, same venue as the Rama Mandali. Same there. Last year also we did. It takes about 2 hours.
Last time we did some elaborate puja. This time I said being a working day and also evening and all that, I have requested my guru to come again this time also. It's a very simple lagu puja for, we want to have, you know, Sri Krishna's presence there before we, so about 15-20 minutes we do a puja and 6 we start, 6:15, 6:20 we start the chanting. You know, depending upon the speed, we can finish by 8:15 very comfortably. And after that, maybe we will give a packed prasada or whatever, so that quickly we can disperse. We are initially thinking we will serve prasada, then you know it gets to 10 o'clock and 9 o'clock. And I think already we want to go home, so we will give a copious prasada, we take home and then we will do something with that, we will discuss that. But please come and join. It was a great experience doing it last year. We were all very happy to do it. So much of vibration we found, over 100 people came last time. Please come. Once in a year we want to do it. We have been going through the Gita class for the last 5-6 years. Please join for the Akhanda Gita.
6 o'clock.
If you come, give or take 5 minutes, we'll start. 6-5 maximum we'll start.
Next week there will not be class.
So therefore there is no class here next week. So we will meet on 28th of December. And at that time I will summarize the Brahmanandavalli. 4th of January we will start with the Siksha only. Well, last year we started with 5th of January only, we started Taittiriya Upanishad. 1 year we have gone only this far. 44 classes we have done. So anyway, thank you.